Hello everyone, I am Tanvi Kaur and I welcome you to this series called RBI 247. In this very series, we pick up some important financial topics and we try to discuss them with the help of different questions. So before beginning up with the session, for all those who are watching this video for the very first time, you can subscribe to our channel and press this bell icon for all latest updates and notifications. You can also join our Telegram group where we share some free quizzes, the updates for all our videos, and you can also post your queries over here. Before beginning the session, there is a piece of information for you all. As you all know that exams are around the corner, so in order to help you prepare better for your RBI Grade B exams, we have launched a crash course. This crash course is being offered at a 40% discount offer. You can use this coupon code and avail the discount. You can fetch further details related to the course from our website. So let's get started now. This is the very first question. Let's have a look at it. It says, Paytm is India's leading financial services company that offers full-stack payments and financial solutions to the customers along with banking, investment and financial services. So, an example of Paytm has been given over here. Next, they say Razorpay is a payment company that provides payment solutions and allows online business to accept, process and disburse the digital payments through several payment modes like debit cards, credit cards, net banking, UPI, prepaid digital wallets. So this is another example, and the third example is of MobiKwik. It started as a digital payment company providing a mobile phone based payment system and a digital wallet. So they are giving you three different examples that how you can use these digital platforms to basically make your or access the financial services. So you can make payments online, you can use e-wallets, debit card, credit card to make different kinds of payments. So let's have a look at the question, which is framed on the basis of these examples. So the question says, what is the term given to such firms that offer different financial services utilizing the technology, building up different digital platforms? So there are three keywords which you have to identify from here. They are offering the financial services, using the technology, and building digital platforms. Now you have to identify the term which is used for such firms. What they are talking about? They are talking about such firms which are operating digitally. So they are providing you the financial services with an aid of technology. They are using technology, the digital platforms to render you different financial services. So what do we call such firms? Let's have a look at these options. So the first one is DigiPlayers, then we have e-leaders, then we have digital agents, then the tech companies, and then fintechs. Now you might be confused that the answer may be DigiPlayer or digital agent or fintech or maybe a tech company as well. So these are quite similar kinds of examples. These are digital players, so you may think that the answer should be A. They are acting as digital agents in rendering you the services, so you may think that answer is option C, but you have to find the closest answer. Agar aise options hote hain which confuse you, to aapko inme se kya sabse zyada apt lagta hai, sabse zyada close lagta hai to the question asked over here. So using the three keywords which I have highlighted, you can answer this question. So let's have a look at those keywords. So the keywords say that you are rendering the financial services using technology and different digital platforms. So there is a term which is quite trending these days, and that is fintech. Fintech has been derived from two different words, which are finance and technology. So fintechs are referred to those firms which are actually using the technology to provide the access to different financial services. So the answer to this question is option E. Now let's talk a bit about these fintechs. Now, in each and every aspect of life these days, we are using some or the other technological platform or digital means, be it buying different goods online, be it basically rendering the health services online, be it taking online classes. So everything has gone online, especially after this pandemic situation. There has been a boost to the digital platforms. So why not get the access to the financial services also online? Obviously, when you are buying the goods and services online, you are making payments. For that, you are using online platforms like debit card, credit card, or maybe you are making the payments through your e-wallets or directly UPI transfers, net banking. What are all these? All these are the technologies, the digital means which you are using to render the financial services. So not only this, you can also buy different financial products online. You want to make a purchase of some kind of insurance policy, you can go to policybazaar.com. So what are all these? These are technological platforms which are rendering you financial services using the technology, or basically providing you such access through digital platforms. So before moving further, let me discuss a bit more about these fintechs. It's a really very important topic added to your syllabus, and a question is likely to be expected from this topic in your upcoming exams. So I told you fintech stands for finance and technology. So all those firms who are using technology to provide the financial services are fintech companies. Now this concept has not been a new concept, but a new term has been given to them, that is fintechs. If you move back and you see that you were already making payments through your debit cards, through your credit cards, through ATMs, you were withdrawing money. What were all these? All these were some financial innovations which took place at that point in time. Then came up the internet, and it allows using all these systems digitally. So internet gave a big boost to this. Not only internet, smartphones are play a very important role, because these smartphones are allowing you to make use of internet to get access to financial services. So all these are actually examples of different technological developments which have taken place in the field of finance. Now let's talk a bit about some pros and cons of fintech. It will help you in answering the question which will come up next. So if I talk about some pros and cons, what are the advantages of using fintech? Now, if you want to say make payment to someone, you are not having money, so you may go to a bank to withdraw the money. It will be a sheer waste of time and effort. When you can make a payment sitting at your home with a click of mouse, then why go to a bank? So that is why we need the digital platforms, different technologies which will help in easing out the process. It will provide you more convenience, more economical way of getting access to any kind of a service. So it is economical. You don't need to go to some place to make the payment, to withdraw the money. You can just do it by sitting at your house itself. Moreover, it will be beneficial for the companies providing such services as well, because the things are going online, so less need of maintaining the things, because technology will do the same thing. So less of your effort needed. Moreover, you are getting the access to such services at an economical cost. You don't have to pay extra to make payment online. You are having a debit card, you are having e-wallet, you can make a payment. You don't have to pay extra to create your e-wallets or make payments online. There are payment gateways which allow you to make those kinds of payments. Moreover, the speed with which the transactions get processed, it's very quick. You don't have to waste your time. Just by a click, your payment gets made, or you can transfer the money from one account to the other, right? Then it has enhanced the efficiency for the financial service companies which are rendering such services. Moreover, it is providing you the flexibility to access the service as and when you want 24/7. Moreover, you can get the access to such services in a customized manner. You can plan out the things according to your needs as per your wants. So another advantage is that of financial inclusion. I took a separate session on financial inclusion. So people must be aware of such things in order to be able to access them. And these digital platforms, each and every person these days is aware of these platforms, leaving behind certain population. So we need to educate them to make them aware that you can access such financial services at low cost in a really very economical and quick manner. So by doing so, by providing the access to each and every person who don't have to visit a bank or any institution to get the access to any kind of financial product or service, it is actually promoting your concept of financial inclusion. Either people were earlier not having the access to such services, or if they were having, they were not aware about the existence of such things. So they were financially illiterate. We need to make them aware about the existence of such products, and it is likely to give a boost to your financial inclusion concept and enhancing the digital platforms of using the financial services. Now, as you all know, everything comes up with the with some pros as well as cons. So what are the limitations of using fintech platforms? So if I talk about some limitations, obviously if you are using online platforms, you must be worrying about the privacy breaches or any kind of a cybersecurity risk. Earlier, people were quite worried, and that was the reason why they were not making use of online payment systems. They were worried that their information might be misused. But now people have changed their ideology and they have started accepting these platforms to be more secure. Moreover, there are different acts in place to regulate such cyber crimes, to help you out in case any problems arise. So people are now shifting more and more towards online platforms, especially after the pandemic kind of situation where you all were under a situation of lockdown, and these digital platforms helped a lot in making the payments online or purchasing anything online. So privacy breaches and cyber securities are, although some of the risks or the limitations of these fintechs, but over time these risks and privacy breaches have been reduced with different things which are in place to deal with them. Moreover, still a lot of population is digitally illiterate. They don't know how to use such service, or if they know, they are not utilizing them, thinking that they may lead to some kind of a privacy breach. So that digitally illiterate consumers are the ones who are left behind. But over time, steps have been taken to support your objective of financial inclusion. So now let's move ahead with our next question. So this is question number 2, which says, which of the following statement is or are correct about fintechs? Now, as I've already discussed the basic concept with you all and some of the pros and cons, you can answer this question easily. So let's have a look at it. The first statement says, the fintechs, because of their speed and economical ways of rendering services, played a key role in making financial sector more efficient. Obviously, I discussed this with you, that speed and economical are some of its advantages, and it is helping to give a boost to the financial sector. As more and more people are able to access such services and they are using it because of the speed and the economical ways with which such services are rendered. The second statement says, fintechs are not useful in serving the purpose of financial inclusion. This statement is obviously wrong. It is actually promoting your concept of financial inclusion, helping to provide the access to such services to as many people as possible. The third statement says, the increasing popularity of fintechs could also have negative repercussions of data misuse, protection, and privacy concerns. So these are few limitations which I discussed up with you in the previous slide. So the statements which are correct are first and third. So the answer is option C. Now let's move on to question number 3. So this question says, which of the following statements is or are incorrect about fintech? So please read the question carefully, whether it is asking you about the correct statements or the incorrect ones. So from here, we have to identify the incorrect statements. The first one says, KYC, Aadhaar, technological developments like internet, smartphones have given a great boost to fintechs. So this statement is absolutely correct. I told you that if there is no internet, you can't make the payments online. So internet has supported a lot. Then if you are not having a smartphone, then you can't use internet facility. So smartphones are obviously giving a boost. Moreover, KYC, Aadhaar, they are handling your privacy breaches kind of thing and ensuring more transparency. So all these are likely to give great boost to more and more fintechs, that is financial technology companies. Second statement says, favorable Indian demography is an enabler for fintechs as the Indian market is blessed with a high proportion of young population who are more likely to trust and adopt fintech. So if I talk about some of the enablers of fintech, enablers in the sense, what are the things which are supporting these fintechs? Obviously, internet was one of them, then the smartphones, this KYC, Aadhaar linking. And another advantage in a country like India is the India's demography. If you are aware about the Indian demography, then we have a lot of working population, young age group. So young age group is more tech savvy. They are more prone to using the technology for different actions, be it purchasing the things online, be it making payments online, or be it doing anything online. So they are likely to give a boost to these fintechs. So this statement is again correct. Talking about the third one, it says, with their increased expansion and lack of tighter regulations, they are posing a major threat to financial stability. Obviously, they are expanding, but we still are lacking behind in proper regulatory setup. If we will have more strong regulations, we will be able to handle them in a more better manner. So this statement is again correct, that if you are not able to have a tighter regulation, then it's going to lead you to financial instability. So we had to identify the incorrect statements in this question. None of these statements is incorrect. All of them are correct. So answer is option E. Now let's move on to question number 4. It says, which of the following is not a fintech innovation? So here different kinds of technologies have been stated and we have to identify that which of them is not a fintech innovation. So let me discuss some fintech innovations with you all. I already told you that debit card, credit card, ATM, internet, e-wallets are some of the basic technologies or digital platforms which you can use to make the payments or to access any kind of financial services. Now let's have a more broader look at these different kinds of innovations, and I will discuss some important terms with you all, and you should be aware of such financial innovations. So the first one which I would like to tell you is related to making payments, settling out the things. So the first one is mobile and web-based payment system. The most easiest one, you can make the web payments using debit cards, credit cards. You can make use of net banking, mobile banking, immediate payment services with the help of mobiles. So all these services are there, different mobile apps are there to make the payments using the aid of technology. So this is the most basic thing which you are aware of. Let's move ahead to the second one, which is related to digital currencies. Now you are having a 100 rupee note or you are having 500 rupees. That is a physical currency which you are having. When you are holding any currency in a digital form, that is in any kind of an electronic form, then that is referred to as digital technology, the digital currency. So digital currency is the electronic currency, usually not backed by any country, not there in any particular currency, but you can have the access to such currencies, a major example being bitcoins. So bitcoin is a cryptocurrency. Cryptocurrency is that currency which is an electronic currency, a digital currency which is making use of cryptography. Cryptography means to make use of some codes, so that encrypting the data so that it cannot be misused by other people. So only they can access the code who are actually are allowed to do so. So Bitcoin is a kind of a digital currency. You can hold it, you can buy it, you can sell it like other securities, but If you are aware that this term is quite trending these days, because in a country like India, where we are thinking of banning all the private digital currencies and launching up a new currency for your Indian markets. So earlier also what RBI did was that it basically denied, didn't allow certain banks and financial institutions to issue this digital currency. So the things were challenged in court and the decision went against RBI. Again, this situation is prevailing and we are thinking about going basically launching our own digital currency. So a bill is pending, a crypto bill has been basically submitted for approval and it is being discussed in the ongoing parliamentary sessions. So let's see what is going to be the decision taken. That bill is related to banning all private currencies or private digital currencies in India and launching a Indian digital currency. Now, after discussing this digital currency, let's move ahead with the technology behind these digital currencies. So the technology which is used is the blockchain technology. So what is this blockchain technology? It's basically like you are storing data in a database. So if you use a database where you electronically store data in the form of tables, blockchain is also another kind of technology which allows you to store data in the form of blocks. So if you have to save any data, you will create a block will be created where all data will be put in. Once this block gets filled up, further new data will be added in another block, and once that block also gets filled, so these two blocks will be linked together, chained together. Once this block gets filled, further data will be added in a new block and then it will again be chained to the previous block. This is known as blockchain technology. Obviously, you will not be able to understand the technicalities that how it functions. There is science behind it. So they are basically what you have to understand is that the technology behind your digital currencies or Bitcoin is blockchain technology, where they store data in blocks and each block is chained up with the previous block. Moreover, the data which you are putting in, it cannot be reversed back. If you want to make some changes, you have to make a new entry which will be added either in existing block if there is still some space, otherwise it will be added in a new block. So this is blockchain technology. Now let's move ahead that how you can make the deposits or lend and borrow using these innovative products. So some financial innovations in that regard are, first, your crowdfunding. When a crowd of people fund your project, now you have to say fund any kind of a project, any kind of a social action, what you can do, you need money. So you can use internet platform where you can raise money from different investors. So small amount of money will be raised from different investors to fund your project. This is crowdfunding. Then we have peer-to-peer lending platforms. We have discussed a lot about these in one of the previous sessions as well, where peer-to-peer lending platforms are the platforms which help link together the lenders and the borrowers. Now let's move ahead to smart contracts. So what are these smart contracts? These are actually the computer protocols. So you want to execute any kind of a contract related to some financial product, say be it a Bitcoin only, so computer protocol or computer program which will run it, it will take all the necessary data, process it, verify all the documents and basically conduct all the transactions. So that is a smart contract, contract done electronically through the use of different computer programs. Next, what we have is cloud computing. So what is this cloud computing? When you are using different financial services using the internet, be it storing the things online, be it using different servers, different database maintained online by others, that is cloud computing. I'll give you a very simple example. For example, you need to store some data. So you will not need a pen drive or any other physical device to store the data. You can upload it on iCloud or you can upload it on Google Drive. So what are these? These are examples of cloud computing where you are using the access to different financial services like storage, like servers like database which are already existing on internet. So this is cloud computing. Then we have e-aggregators. E-aggregators are the ones which help you compare different financial products. So you want to have a comparison of different prices, of different features offered by different financial products providers. You can do so with the help of e-aggregators. Now we are moving on. Next one more was left as e-trading. We want to trade online. We can use different e-trading platforms. There are different apps, different softwares with which we can basically say buy and sell our securities or get access to any other financial products. So electronic trading is being done. That is e-trading. Earlier, when the Bombay Stock Exchange existed, it was following a physical means of exchange. Then we shifted onto the electronic platform to dematerialization. So all these are covered under some kind of financial innovations which have taken place. Now we are moving to an era of artificial intelligence and robotics, where we are taking up the robo advisors. What is the future of these financial innovations? It will be computers acting as humans and providing you all kinds of financial services, all kinds of financial advices. Suppose you need a person to advise you on different financial matters. What will happen in case of the robo-advisors? A machine will be equipped with such knowledge that it can help advise you on different financial aspects. So instead of a person, you'll need a machine, and it will advise you on how to get the access to different financial products, where you should invest, how you should invest. Using the smart contracts, you can transact the things with the use of computers, and the things will be solved. So everything will go online, everything will be handled by the machines, by the technology, reducing our workload and easing up the ways we are accessing such services. Obviously, it will save time, it will save cost, it will make things more efficient. So these are few fintech innovations. It's not a complete list. You can have many other fintech innovations as well. India is following almost all of these. And we are even, as I told you, we are even thinking of coming up with our own digital currency. So if I move back to the question and read these options, we have to identify which is not a fintech innovation. So blockchain technology is, I've already explained you about it. Cloud computing, I've also explained. These two I have not told you. So photovoltaic technology, it's the technology used behind solar cells, which are used to generate electricity. So it's not a financial technology innovation. Then mountain computing, this is a hypothetical option created to confuse you because of cloud computing. So it is again not the answer. So second and fourth are not fintech innovations. So answer is option D. This was all for today's session. Fintech is a really very important topic. You must be aware about the concept. You can quote different examples. You can tell about its pros and cons. You must be aware of different fintech innovations. Then whether India is implementing them or not, what is the regulatory structure in India to regulate these fintech companies? All that is very important from descriptive point of view as well as your objective point of view. So do prepare this topic well. With this, I would like to end up this session. Thank you so much.